Students, we are going to start the next topic, which is surface texturing and roughness. All surfaces have their own textures and they have got their own roughness. So it is basically distinct to each surface. And when we talk about the production of different types of surface texture means that every single surface is going to have its own characteristics such as roughness, waviness, lay, flaws, etc. So although the description of surface texture is quite complex, but however we will characterize it based on four things. So I will go to the next slide and we will see that when we talk about surface texture, we identify surface texture based on flaws, then lay, then waviness, and then roughness. So what are these four things? When you talk about flaws, flaws are basically random irregularities such as scratches, okay, or cracks or craters, something like that. Whereas when we talk about the lay, it basically gives the directionality, the direction in which the whole surface is predominant, whether it is in this direction, it is going upwards, it is wavy, etc. So this is something which is defined by the directionality. Next, we move on to the waviness. Waviness is basically defined as the deviation, okay, it is the deviation between the highest peak and the lowest valley. Okay, so this is waviness in terms of height. And when we talk about the space between the crest and the valleys, crest is also the highest part and valley is the lowest part. So when we talk about the horizontal distance between the maximum crest and the maximum peak, then that horizontal distance, as you can see, is the waviness width. So these are the first three important characteristics which are required for defining surface texture. Next, we move on to the roughness. Roughness is basically defined as a closely spaced and irregular deviation. So you can see closely spaced irregular deviations on a small scale, and it is expressed in terms of height. Okay, so we can express in terms of height, width, and the distance along the surface. So these are the four most important things that are required to be define when we talk about surface texture. And in the next slide we are going to look at how surface roughness is defined, because this is one of the most important characteristics or feature of a students. So now we are going to move on to the surface roughness. There are basically two basic type of methods by which we calculate surface roughness. Number one is arithmetic mean value, which is denoted by RA, as you can see here in the formula. And number two is RQ or RMS, which is also known as root mean square value. And there are other parameters as well for which I will give you the links, which basically measure different types of surface characteristics. However, for the sake of simplicity, we are going to be studying RA, RQ and RT. In the next video and slide, I will be discussing how RA and RQ are measured and basically what does RT means. Okay guys, so now we are going to have a look at what is roughness, surface roughness. So surface roughness is basically defined as closely spaced and irregular deviations on a small scale, and it is expressed in terms of its height, width and distance along the surface. So let's just say that we have got one axis, this is the y-axis, okay, and I have got my surface, and that surface could be anything. It could be a surface of a table or a machine surface or a machine CNC block, something like that. Okay, now in order to calculate surface roughness, I need to create a datum line. Okay, and that datum line, let's say it should be from A to B, and the datum line between line A to B should be such that the area above the sum of areas above the line is equal to the sum of areas below the line. So the sum of areas above the lines should be equal to the sum of areas below the line. So I am going to, let's say for example, I am going to create this line from A to B, assuming that the sum of areas is equal from A to B.
What does it mean is that these number of area, this percentage of area, which is has been highlighted in red color, is equals to the area which has been highlighted by the black color. Okay, so when we have obtained this normalcy or this equivalency, then only we can proceed with calculating the surface roughness. So I will be making this line once again. So here we have this is my y-axis, and I will be creating this surface again. Okay, and now I'm going to create my datum line, okay, which is from A to B. So this is A, this is B, and this is the x-axis. Okay, so surface roughness can be basically generally characterized by two methods. Number one is arithmetic mean method, and the arithmetic mean method is basically called RA, arithmetic mean method. In arithmetic mean method, what happens is that it is based on this is illustration which I'm going to show you now. Let's say that we have got small points, okay, at equal distance, and now I'm going to measure the distance from here to here, here to here, here to here. Okay, these will be minus because they are in the negative direction. So these are the distance which I am going to measure, and I am going to take a mean of them. So it will give me an average distance of the y in the y direction. So RA, let's say this is A, point A, point B, point C, point D, then RA becomes arithmetic mean value. RA is equals to A plus B plus C plus so on, whole divided by the number of points. So I have n number of points in this direction. I have n number of points. So this is equals to, you know, divided by n. Okay, where A, B, C, these values are in absolute coordinates. Okay, so if B is in negative direction, then the value will be negative, and if A is in positive direction, then the value will be positive. So this is called arithmetic mean value method, based on the vertical readings A, B, C, D that we have taken place. There is another factor, or there is another method, or there is another parameter which is called root mean square roughness. Root mean square method. And the formula for root mean square, as the name suggests, root mean square is denoted by RQ, or previously it was denoted by RMS. This is equals to under root A square plus B square plus C square plus so on, whole divided by n value. Okay, so these are two most important and most famous methods which are used for getting surface methods, surface roughness values. There are other also what you call parameters, such as R Z, R T, okay, R S, R S. So there are various other parameters as well, and each of them give specific information. For instance, if I talk about another roughness parameter, which is maximum roughness, which is denoted by RT. So RT can be basically defined as the height of the deepest trough to the height of highest peak. So if I have got this, okay, I have got a very large peak and I have got a very deep trough, okay, so the height between them, okay, from the height from the peakest valley to the deepest trough is RT, okay. So this is a peak and this is a trough. So there are different types of information that we can obtain based on what kind of parameter and what kind of information is required for us to basically calculate and obtain. So arithmetic mean method, we've got root mean square values, RMS values or RQ, and then we've got a maximum roughness, which is RT.
Okay, students, so we have already talked about RA and RQ. So because of simplicity, RA is basically defined internationally by ISO and it is usually adopted internationally. When we talk about RA, roughness parameters, then the unit for surface roughness is microns, and microns is like micrometer, so it is basically microns, and it is also expressed in micro inches. So when we talk about micro inches, basically, then we can write that in the form of micro IN, okay? So these are the units for surface roughness. If we talk about the ratio of RQ over RA, okay, then basically it gives us some information. For instance, if the ratio of RQ over RA is equals to 1.1, then basically some machining process has been carried out or some finishing process has been carried out. So these are the ratios which are basically internationally recognized and adopted. Let's say for instance, grinding, we usually adopt RQ over RA 1.2 ratio, and for lapping and awning, RQ over RA ratio comes out to be 1.4. So these are some of the ranges by which we can define which machining operation has been performed. When we talk about RA or RQ, only RA and RQ are not enough. As I said earlier, layness, the waviness, okay, the directional lay all is also important. So maybe sometimes two surfaces might have the same surface roughness. However, because of the change in surface texture, the lay, the flaws, different properties are expected. For instance, the friction between two materials might be different, although the surface roughness is same, but the friction coefficient, the fatigue characteristics, the wear, that these are some things that we will learn in the next class. These are the properties which also depends on surface roughness, but however, it does not solely depend on roughness, because two roughness, although they are equal, can have different characteristics in the form of lay, in the form of direction, in the form of waviness, in the form of the flaws. So I have collected some different types of surface parameters. The three basic ones we have already discussed, which were RA, RQ and RT. However, here we have got additional parameters in the form of RP, RV, RC, RT, RTA we have discussed, then skewness and other things. So I have given you the link and you guys can go and click this link to see in based on the diagram what is exactly this parameter about. It will show you the distance between the crest and the valley, or between the peak and the valley. So crest and peaks are the highest or upper terms, or the upper part of the roughness profile, whereas valley is basically the lower part. So these are some of the parameters that you can click on and see and visualize basically how they look. So students, now that you know about the surface roughness parameters, we need to see and understand how to write symbols on drawings and how do we define or express them. So if we take a look at some of the surface roughness parameters and how to define their symbols, then you can see that you have got a check mark. This is kind of an under root mark, okay? So under root marks are basically the marks under which we can define the acceptable limits for the surface roughness. and this is basically specified for technical drawings. And you can see that the check mark is shown, and below this check mark on the right hand side are some of the roughness, width cutoff and maximum roughness. So basically these are the limits which are placed. And the limits, some of the RA limits are placed on the left hand side of the check marks, and the width based limits are placed on the right hand side of the check mark. And on the lower right hand mark, you can see you've got a lay direction. So symbols basically and the meaning concerning lay are basically given in the lower corner. And what does this lay means? As I told you, lay gives the directionality of the surface. So for lay, there are different types of symbols used. For instance, if the lay of the surface looks like parallel, then you've got an equal sign. Then if you have got an across one, then you've got like a perpendicular sign. So we've got different cross and different N based concentric, radial and non-directional lay. So these are all typical example of lays and how do you define the lay symbol within the check mark. So based on this technical drawing symbols and surface roughness specification for technical drawing, waviness, surface roughness and the lay information can be given. However, the flaw direct information, the information which is related to the defects, is not given. So wherever necessary, it is important that you mention or put a special note in the technical drawing for the defect or for the flaw, whether how to inspect it, and give instructions on the perhaps whether there should be any flaw, is it allowable or not allowable, etc. So these are some of the guidelines regarding technical drawing and how to specify the surface roughness. On your left hand side is information related to the RA and maximum height, whereas on the left hand right hand side you have got the information related to the width of the surface, and on the bottom right hand side of the check mark we have got information about the lay and what is the characteristic of the lay. So students, let us move on to the surface roughness values based on various surface processing operations or different machining operations. And as you can see in the figures, you have got different machining operations such as turning, rough grinding, you've got lapping, and then you've got finishing process. So as you can see here, turning process is generating a surface roughness average value of 5 microns, which is quite rough, and this can be seen in terms of the significant amount of variation in the peaks and valleys, okay, and then they are quite rough and they're quite deep, okay. This is not the case for rough grinding. However, rough grinding is also producing 3.8 microns surface roughness values. However, the significant variation which can be seen for turning is not very much visible. However, at intermittent distances, you can see some deep perhaps valleys. Next, we move on to some kind of finishing operation. And let's say you do a very fine grinding operation, something like that. So here you can get into less than a micron. So when you get some kind of a less than a micron surface finish, then it moves towards smoother surface. And in case of polishing process, like you guys do for your cars, automobile, metal surfaces, polishing technique is done. And then further to polishing is an advanced level called lapping. So in lapping, you can see you have further reduced the surface roughness to about 0.5 microns. We can, in our labs, using grinding machines, using very good nano diamond grinding fluid and polishing fluid, as well as alumina, 3 micron, 6 micron, 1 micron fluids can be used to significantly reduce the surface roughness, and we can go to about 0.05 to 0.01 micrometers for our polished samples. So you can literally see your face in that polished part of the metal. So these are some of the operations which are carried out for machining purpose, and then what is the surface finish that we get from various machining operations. Now we are going to have a look at some of the surface textures. What kind of machining operation creates what kind of range of surface roughness, and what is the tolerance limit? Tolerance is basically the permissible limit of variation in physical dimension. So how much limitation in physical dimensions is given is the tolerance, and the lesser is the tolerance, basically it means how accurately you can basically create your product. So if you can look, you can see that this table has been divided into abrasive flow machining, then it has been divided into electrical based machining, then we have got thermal based, chemical based, and conventional machining. And if you can see, one of the best or least surface roughness, if you want very smooth and very polished surface, or perhaps almost near to the polished surface, then you can see that these green icons are the average application anticipated values, and you can reach 0.1 very easily for electro polishing, surface grinding, and then that's it. So only these two techniques can give you a very good surface finish. The blue marks and these light brown marks are showing that if you have a very special parameter, and under rare circumstances you can go beyond that, or you can reduce the surface finish quite less. So in case of electro polishing, you can go further beyond to 0.025. So that's one condition. And some of the process like surface grinding, turning, and electrochemical grinding and abrasive flow machining can, in some rare cases, can give you very good surface quality. Same goes for the tolerance as well. So for very good tolerance, you can see that the mechanical machining processes are kind of able to give good tolerances, and quite less variation in the tolerances. And you can see that plasma beam machining is giving you, I mean, quite a great, very high value of tolerance. So you can see the trend of tolerance as we move from abrasive to ultrasonic, and then you can see the trend of tolerance moving the maximum limit in turning and surface grinding. So what you can observe is that surface roughness varies a lot, and tolerance varies a lot within the type of mechanical or electrical machining, as well as within the full categories of these types of machining techniques. So it depends on what you want, whether your priority is surface roughness or your priority is tolerance. It depends on your product quality and what is your function of the product, and whether what is your focus, what is the quality that you want to give. So these are some of the important points that you need to consider when selecting the process of machining for getting the required quality of surface roughness in addition to the tolerance that you are going to get. So students, we are going to move on to the last topic for the surface integrity characteristics and surface roughness, which is surface roughness measurement. So basically, we are going to look at what are the different types of techniques which are used for measuring the surface roughness. So let us take a look at
visual surface finish comparator. Let's talk about the visual surface roughness comparator. And that's what we have right here. This guy's an awesome visual tool or visual reference for apprentices, because it allows them to be able to see right away what type of finish they're getting while they're machining, which is kind of cool. These are not to be touched. Everyone wants to touch them. Oh, I'm running my fingernail up and down them. You're not going to get a super true reading by running your fingernail up and down, because they have a bit of a coating on them. Although this guy's nickel, made out of nickel because it's a nickel plated process, how they actually make these. This visual comparator here, if you look really closely right here, there's actually a hair stuck inside of this sample. How I know this is because I ran the surface roughness tester over top, and I wasn't getting an accurate reading for what the actual specimen was saying.
Example or type number one, which is surface profilometer. So surface profilometer basically are a stylus based mechanical device, and basically what happens is that we've got a head, and then this whole system is called a stylus. then we've got this rider, and then we've got a very small tip called stylus. So the surface profilometer are used to measure and record surface roughness, and they've got diamond stylus that travels along a straight line. Now how much this travel, this the distance that it travels depends on how much length that we want to cover, and that is called cutoff length. So the minimum cutoff length usually is 0.08 millimeter to that of 25 millimeters. And if you look at this stylus, then this stylus has specific amount of nose radius. So because of that nose radius, it cannot actually go through all the surface. As you can see, it has to omit some of the spaces. So perhaps this measurement technique is might not be as accurate. However, it is still a reliable way of getting the average. So what happens is that that stylus basically covers the smoother part based on the nose radius, not the actual path. So we have two paths. One is the actual path and one is the stylus path. So stylus measurement machine basically incorporates the approximations and then it is able to deliver us the approximate results.
Working principle. When the stylus is moved over the surface which is to be measured, the irregularities in the surface texture are measured, and it is used to assess the surface finish of the workpiece. Working of stylus probe instrument. The stylus type instruments consist of skid, stylus, amplifying device, and recording device. The skid is slowly moved over the surface by hand or by motor drive. The skid follows the irregularities of the surface, and the stylus moves along with skid. When the stylus moves vertically up and down, and the stylus movements are magnified, amplified, and recorded to produce a trace, then it's
surface roughness tester. So why do I keep calling this a surface roughness tester? Because that's what Mitch Otoyo calls it. This also comes with a precision reference specimen. If you looked at this, we used this earlier today when we calibrated the machine. For extra references and zeroing and changing the different parameters, we use these buttons here. When we flip it over, if we push backwards, this guy will be released, and we can also unplug this. Now you can mount this to a surface gauge or any other type of piece of equipment. Then use this extension cord to go from here back into the unit. So 119.7, and this guy's supposed to be 120, so 0.3 off. When you have one of these electronic units, it's really easy to switch between RA, RZ, and RQ just by switching the parameters. Surface roughness tester, skidded versus probe. But what I want to talk more about is the stylus on the end here. If you take a look, you see that there's a tiny little needle sticking out the end there. That tiny little needle is actually what feeds back information into the system. But this is called a skidded type probe because it actually rides on the bump that's here. This can only check flat surfaces. It can't really check tapered surfaces or round surfaces. Now, if you have just the individual stylus sticking out, a non-skidded type, what happens is you can check round surfaces, tapers, and a few other things. But with this style, you're limited to only checking flat work pieces. Surface roughness tester setup. It is important to be perpendicular when you're setting this up. If not, you'll get cosine error. And if you're unsure of what cosine error is, check out my YouTube video, Cosine Error Explained. With a skidded probe, it is very important to be parallel to the surface to which you're checking. Not so much with a probe style, but with a skidded, it is extremely important. Checking the surface finish of a circular object. It is not possible to do this with a skidded style. It is possible to do it with a probe, though. Checking the surface finish of a groove. It may not be possible to do this with a skidded stylus due to space restraints. compared to a probe.
However, if you want to increase the accuracy, go to submicron levels, perhaps 100 nanometer, 10 nanometers, or even at atomic levels, then we have got additional surface roughness measurement machines. So we are going to move to them. One of them is optical interference microscopy. So basically, it shines the light on a surface, and then based on the data which is reflected back, it basically takes measurements. So 3D optical microscopy or optical interference microscopy are available in UMP, and perhaps I can show you some of the videos on that. And then the next but not the least is...
Meet the Nanovia 3D non-contact profilometer. In portable, compact, standard and high-speed versions, our profilometer uses a wide selection of superior white light axial chromatism optics to measure more geometries and more surfaces than any other. During surface profiling, Nanovia's user-friendly software provides an almost infinite range of user tools to evaluate roughness, finish, and texture. Profile and dimension. Topography, shape, and form. Flatness, warpage, and planarity. Volume and area. Step height, depth, and thickness.
Does Edgemaster give you the opportunity to guarantee better tooling from the manufacturing process for your customers?
Certainly. The Alicornier equipment that we use actually forms part of our quality assurance system. So every tool that we produce here, we have inspection frequencies that we must follow to ensure it's a quality product every time the customer orders it. With the use of the Alicornier equipment, we can actually generate ports that are very, very easy and very quick to produce. And they also have quite a lot of detail as well. So we can interrogate and analyse the cutting edge in quite a lot of detail. That then forms part of our quality reports, which are then filed for future reference in case of quality concerns.
And how often would you use the Edgemaster?
We use it on a daily basis. It depends on the product and the application, whether it actually needs a hone or not. If it does, we would use it on every single product that we hone.
The atomic force microscopy, which is the most precise surface roughness measurement equipment. You can see in the figure, you've got basically a tip, and that is AFM, atomic force microscopy tip. It has a height of about 8 to 20 microns, and it has got a specific angle, opening angles, and the apex radius is around about 10 nanometers. So basically with this microscope, we can perhaps go as deep as atoms, and we can feel the texture of atoms as well. So atomic force microscopy is used to measure the roughness of very smooth surfaces, because if you have a very rough surface, then the diamond or the edge of this probe can become damaged. So next we are going to move into what are the engineering practices which are used for surface roughness. The reason why surface engineering is important is because different applications have different types of surfaces functions. So for instance, if you look about ball bearings, then they have to be very smooth so that the rollers and the cages and the inner rays basically move across and along over each other. So for that purpose, you can see that the surface roughness requirement is very, very strict, 0.025 microns. So if you are going to look at the inner surfaces of the bearing, then you can see that it is very, very shiny. And then if you take a look at another type of bearing called crankshaft bearing, then it is also 0.032, quite less. But once our requirement changes to brake drums, then brake drums need to be a bit rough as well on the rougher side. So for that purpose, we have 1.6 microns of recommended surface finish. Then we want to clutch disc plate. So for them, we need more holding power, more friction. So friction, to improve friction, we have more rougher surface. So because of many materials and process variables are involved, the range of surface roughness produced even within the same manufacturing process can be significant. So it depends on the cooling state, it depends on the weather, it depends on many noise factors of the machining process that will produce a roughness, even though it is going through the same type of machine. So same type of machine, same product, but sometimes the environment changes, sometimes some kind of parameter changes, so that could produce some variation in the surface roughness that is produced. So
hi, I am Pralat Thapa. I am project manager at Mitutoyo Europe. I will show you how to conduct surface roughness measurement with Mitutoyo surface roughness tester SJ210. Mitutoyo surface roughness tester SJ210 is a portable measuring instrument that allows you to easily and accurately measure surface roughness. The instrument is very practical for on-site measurement applications. The drive unit can be separated from the display unit using a cable, allowing more flexible measurements. Data can be quickly transferred to and from a computer via high-speed USB interface. The free download software USB communication tool is available in our webpage for making a test reports or even start the measurements. Let's switch the device on. The Surface SJ210 has a colored LCD display that provides excellent readability and an intuitive interface. The LCD also features a backlight for improved visibility in dark environments. Now, I would like to introduce you to the simple and quick use of Mitutoyo Surface SJ210. So, let us conduct a roughness measurement on this workpiece with the compact portable device. We start by pressing the menu button. Now I select measurement condition and then setting. First, we define the standard. Mitutoyo Surface SJ210 supports various industrial standards. For this measurement, we select an ISO standard. Now we choose the required profile. We will measure surface roughness, so we select R profile. Then we define the roughness parameters. Surface SJ210 supports various roughness parameters. We use the Gauss filter for this measurement. Lambda C is the filter setting. This is one of the most important settings for roughness measurements. The selection of filter we apply depends upon the tolerance mentioned in the technical drawing. ISO 4288 provides us with the guideline for the selecting the required filter. In this case, I will use 0.25. The SJ210 automatically chooses lambda S according to our selected lambda C. N is the number of our sampling length. According to the ISO standard, 5 is the default. However, it can be changed in the SJ210. Pre-post travel of the detector during the measurement can be switched on or off. If necessary, we can change the measuring speed. Also possible, a change of measuring range according to the measurement position. Now we have finished all the setting for our measurements. Next, we press the start button. The drive unit conducts the measurement and the LCD shows the measured profile. By pressing the page button, we can switch to other pages of the screen. We can check the roughness profile and other detailed information by pressing the page button. For the next measurement, the device remembers the setting, so it is not necessary to redo this process. As you have seen, taking roughness measurement with MeterToyo Softest SJ210 is a quick and easy task.
This was all about information regarding surface integrity characteristics and surface roughness measurement. I hope that you guys had a fruitful lecture on surface measurement. Next, we are going to look at friction and friction measurement systems and what is wear, what are different types of wear modes.